Amen. There was an interesting story that came out of India a few weeks back. The story was told of a gentleman who was having some heart pain, chest pain, and he went to the doctor and ended up on a ventilator for 4 days and ended up dying, ended up flatlining. The medical team did everything they could to resuscitate him, but he perished. He died. And they loaded his body into an ambulance, and they were taking his body to the morgue. And on the way to the morgue, they hit a pothole. The ambulance hit a pothole. And that pothole shook that vehicle so strongly that that man's heartbeat began to beat again. And I'm sure that's the only time that someone has been happy about running over a pothole. But you know, maybe tonight, maybe you're here, and maybe spiritually you feel like you have flatlined. Maybe it's been a while since you have shown some spiritual signs of life. Maybe it's been a while since you lifted up hands in a worship service. Maybe it's been a while since you lifted up your voice in thanksgiving to the Lord, and maybe you've even begun to try to fill that void in other areas. But I want to tell you tonight that all it takes is just a few moments in the presence of God on a Sunday night at the Temple of Pentecost, and you can be restored, you can be revived, you can be renewed, you can receive clarity, you can receive direction, you can receive peace. If you believe that tonight, why don't you lift up your hands? And one more time, let's invite the presence of the Lord into this house. Heavenly Father, we invite your presence into this place. We ask you to come, to heal, to restore, to renew, to strengthen, move in a very special way in this place, empower, minister in this place, God. We lift up your name, Jesus, and we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. Why don't you put your hands together and welcome the worship team as they come at this time.
With your love. Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated tonight. We have one more song, and it's something really special that hasn't been done, at least since I've been here at TOP. We are debuting an original apostolic written song by Brother Kevin Randolph tonight. It's going to be our final song of the set. If you don't know, I'm just going to brag on Brother Kevin. He's a songwriter, he's a singer, a musician, he's a worship leader, and he has gone out and professionally recorded a few songs, and he sent them to me, and so he had one that was kind of about Easter. So we're going to sing it tonight, and we just hope that it blesses you. It's just a reminder that Calvary, that the cross, was all for you, and it was all for me. If you're thankful for that tonight, can you put your hands together?
Lord, you gave your all, left your heavenly throne. You did it all for me to save humanity. I'm so unworthy, but it's the blood you see. You gave it all for me. You
crucified for the world. You stood up for me. You did it all for me, Jesus.
Let's give the Lord praise right now. Let's magnify His name. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Let's give Him some praise right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You gave it all on Calvary. Thank you for your blessing. In Jesus' name. I want to appreciate the great worship of the Temple of Pentecost. This is a great church. You have worship that you give unto God in spite of how you're feeling, in spite of what's going on in your life. We don't come to identify or have self-pity parties, but we come to give praise to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I'm so thankful to see each and every one of you here on Sunday night. Beautiful crowd here tonight. And I want to appreciate Brother Kevin Randolph for using his apostolic talent to produce apostolic music. In fact, there's a number of songs that he has written, recorded. We are so thankful, so excited about that. And what a blessing to the kingdom of God. For so many years, we have used the songs of others. But in the last 10 years at least, I know there are so many apostolic, or so many songs written by apostolics. And I thank God. We are blessed by songs that are written by non-apostolics. But I want to say there's another level when it's written by an apostolic that knows the oneness, revelation, that knows the Word of God. Such a blessing, such anointing upon their lives and the songs. And we are so thankful for that. We're going to receive our gifts, our offering here tonight. And I want to appreciate you for giving faithfully. You may be seated. Let's give unto the Lord tonight. Tithing, our offering. Number of ways that you can give here at the house of God. And in fact, the last couple of weeks I have been teaching in our midweek. The last two Wednesdays I taught a mini series on giving of our finances to God, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And there have been a number of people that have come up to me and said, Pastor, since we have had this Bible study in the last couple of weeks, I've had a position change, an elevation in pay, elevation in position, And it's the faithfulness of the giving of the Temple of Pentecost family. I thank you for giving faithfully to God. In fact, if you're in a financial difficulty, you get out of it by giving. You give to God, and God will bless what's left, and God will bless you abundantly. So I thank you for giving so faithfully to the kingdom and cause of God, and out of your gifts to missions, to the Temple of Pentecost, tithing and offering. We do so many things to bless others, to help others, and I thank you for your gifts here tonight. I do want to let you know that next week, next Sunday morning, we will have, it is our first Sunday of the month, and we will be on our first weekend schedule. There will be no prayer next Saturday night, but next Sunday morning, regular service Sunday morning. Sunday night, we will have family prayer for a portion of that time together. Be casual dress as normal next Sunday night. But also, we will receive communion next Sunday night. So we want to come prepared to receive communion and a special time in the Lord. So we look forward to that coming up very soon. Also, this Wednesday, everyone say this Wednesday. We had a little schedule change. Normally we have Heroes in Training on the last Wednesday of the quarter, but this we did a switch here, and we are going to have Heroes in Training on first Wednesday, which will be not this Wednesday. It will be the 6th of March. So the 6th of March, that first Wednesday, we are going to have Heroes in Training. All classes will be here in the sanctuary on the 6th of March. This coming Wednesday, we will have a missionary with us on the 28th of February, a missionary to Spain. And I'm excited for you to hear this young lady. She is doing some great things, greatly involved in evangelism, greatly involved in campus ministries, and on deputation right now with United Pentecostal Church. And so our bridge will be here in the sanctuary this Wednesday for that. And I know you will be blessed. We look forward to hosting a missionary this coming Wednesday. And we look forward to that. Let's all stand tonight. I want to appreciate the response to the Word of God today. And a number of lives were blessed in this house. Pastor got a little crazy today, but thank the Lord. Many were touched, many were blessed, and thankful that for everyone that was here today. I want to appreciate the team that drives our vans that bring the homeless ministry here today. Brother Jason Pierce and his team, they brought right at 50 today on the vans. Basically, 5 van trips to bring them to the house of God. 5 trips in the church van. And I want to thank this team for their commitment, their love for souls. Can you appreciate them? That's what it's all about. It's all about souls. And I am so thankful for that today. Of course, Brother Jason Pierce and his team, their background, they don't want to be in the limelight. But I just wanted to appreciate them for all of their work. It started with a burden about a year and a half ago or 2 years ago, Brother Jason Pierce. And I'm so thankful to see what God has done. And I think they had 41 last week or 40 last week and right at 50 this week. So we give God praise for that. And we get calls from people every week that need a ride to church. I need some of the saints of the Temple of Pentecost, couples. We need some ladies, some men, some people that can pick up some people to bring them to the house of God. If you can do that, if you would let Brother Nicholas know, we get calls all the time. We need a ride to the Temple of Pentecost. And I don't want to go to eternity with people saying, I wanted to go to church, but I couldn't get there. I didn't have a ride. And so that's a ministry. If you feel a call to ministry, start by picking people up. We need you to pick people up. We need people to be able to be in the house of God. And so I felt to push that this evening, because we need you to, all you have to do, take a friend with you, go pick somebody up, bring them to the house of God, and it will be such a blessing to them. Tonight is a little continuation. I told you sometime back in the month of February, we are having a number of our young ministers here at the Temple of Pentecost to speak on Sunday night. And Brother Grant Wicker spoke a couple of weeks ago, and Brother Nicholas Gilbert spoke last week. Tonight we have Brother Nicholas Egger to preach to us tonight, and we're excited about his love, his passion for ministry, his passion for the kingdom of God. He was licensed by the United Pentecostal Church a couple years ago, and we're so thankful that he is such a blessing here at the Temple of Pentecost. In fact, what we are so thankful for is that he brought Sister Shanda here to the Temple of Pentecost. What a blessing she is to this church, her gifts, her anointing, and we're so thankful for this wonderful couple. They work with our youth, doing such an outstanding job, blessing our teenagers. Also, Top Connect, they help to revamp our Top Connect room, such a blessing to guests. And we are thankful for their love and passion for souls. Would you put your hands together and welcome Brother Nicholas Egger as he comes to minister the Word of God tonight.
All across this place, why don't we lift up our high praise to the King of Kings and to the Lord of Lords. Lord, you're so worthy. God, you are so worthy. We give you all praise. We give you all God. Come on, church people. Why don't we go ahead and give some praise up to God tonight? I don't know about you, but I came into the house of the Lord to give God some high praise. I came into this place not just to sit on a pew to be ministered to, but I came into this place to hear from Almighty God tonight. So why don't you lift up your voices all across this place? Lord, you're worthy. Lord, you're good. Lord, you're holy. I'm so thankful that we're able to live for you. I'm so thankful that you came and you changed my life. I praise you tonight. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, you may be seated. You may be seated. I will quickly turn to the word of the Lord tonight. If you wouldn't mind joining me with Genesis chapter number 22, starting in verse number 6. And as you are turning to that portion of Scripture, I do want to say thank you, Pastor. I love you. I appreciate you. One thing that I love about you, Brother Bowser, and there are many things that I love about you, but one thing that I do love about you so very dearly is your love for truth. Every time you step up to this pulpit, you preach nothing but truth. And I am so thankful that we as a church family have a man of God who is not afraid to stand behind this desk and deliver his heart and deliver what God has to say to his people. I'm so thankful for you. I'm thankful for my family, Shanda. I love you. As many of you guys know, Shanda and I, we got married 2 years ago. And if you ever ask me to do anything, I guarantee she's the one that's doing it for me. And so I thank you. I love you. And I'm so thankful for each and every single one of you here tonight. I could continue to go on and on about all the things that you as a church body have done for me. And I would take up every single ounce of my time thanking every single individual. But if you have had an impact in my life in any sort of way, just know that I love you. And you are a vital part of who I am today. So why don't you go ahead and give yourselves a hand clap for investing into young ministers, but also for investing into my life. Genesis chapter number 22, starting in verse number 6, reads like this. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. Verse 7, and Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, My father. And he said, Here I am, son. And he said, Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they both of them went together. And they came to the place which God had told him of. And Abraham built an altar right there. And he laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him upon the altar of wood. My emphasis tonight here is not about the necessary story of Isaac and Abraham walking hand in hand to this altar, but the emphasis that I want to put here tonight is this, that there was an altar. And so without further ado, I will preach to you tonight with this subject in mind. Do not stub your toe on the altar. Do not stub your toe on the altar. If we could, for just one moment, why don't we lift our hands once again to the King of Kings and have him have his way in this place. Lord, we need you here tonight. God, my desire of you here tonight, Lord, is for you to come and for you to move like you always do. But Lord, I pray here tonight, God, that you would anoint my words, Lord, to say exactly what you would have the body of believers to hear tonight. We ask it all in your precious name. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody say, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. My desire here tonight is not for people to run the aisles, and it's not for there to be an overwhelming sense of response to this altar. But my desire of you tonight and in this service is that we have an uninhibited move of Almighty God. Because in the world today and in our day, in our time, we need nothing more than a genuine move of the Spirit of Almighty God. With the spirit of the age coming around and devouring that which it will, we need something stronger than that, and we have it, and that is a genuine move of God. I don't know about you, but I came here tonight to experience a move of God. And so tonight, written in the 22nd chapter of Genesis, we find here this familiar story of Abraham being asked of God to sacrifice his son Isaac on an altar. But what we find here in this chapter is, of course, the obedience of a man following after the voice of God and the call of God. And make no mistake that Abraham, he was indeed following the will of God in his life. And we can see here in this story that Abraham and Isaac, they walk together hand in hand up to this mountain. And what I think is so intriguing in this story is that Isaac is the one who holds the wood for the altar. And it's as if Abraham was telling Isaac or showing Isaac, son, there are some things that you're going to have to carry yourself whenever you come to sacrifice to God. And so, of course, he plays this out in the same manner where Abraham holds the knife and he holds the fire for this altar. But what's interesting to note here is that Isaac at any point in time could have chosen to walk away from the calling of his dad. But instead, what Isaac decides to do is he decides to embrace the fact that he trusts his dad to lead him not astray, but to lead him in the right direction. And so even though Isaac could have outrun his father, probably could have overtaken his father, he thought it better in himself to follow his dad. But the beautiful thing here is that he did, in fact, walk side by side with Abraham to sacrifice. And so we see here what Abraham is tempted with is not a temptation really of sacrifice. Because if you remember, Abraham was called of God once and he answered and he went. And again, we find that Abraham is tempted of God, if you will, to sacrifice his only son, the one that he loved, on an altar. But rather, I might say to you tonight that instead of just sacrificing his son, the sacrifice that God really wanted was of Abraham's will. And I'm sure that you can imagine with me here tonight the pain and the hurt that Abraham would have faced by taking his son by his hand and walking him up the mountain, knowing full well what was going to take place, and Isaac not being aware of the situation. And I'm sure Isaac put together the context clues like we read in the story. I have wood, there's fire, there's a knife. Oh no, where's the lamb? And I'm sure that caused Isaac some pain in his mind. And as they walk up this mountain to sacrifice, Isaac questions his dad and he says, Dad, where is the sacrifice? And Abraham's response to this, I'm sure, heart-dividing question was, God will provide. God will provide. And the point here is not that the almost sacrifice of Isaac, but it's rather what Abraham showed Isaac through his sacrifice. What he showed him very intimately was how to build an altar. And sometimes, I'm preaching to mothers and fathers here tonight, but sometimes, Dad, you are going to be put in a place where it's going to be very hard for you to say no to some great opportunities because God has asked you to do something else.
If you would hear me tonight, sometimes God is going to ask you and put you in a place of difficult situations financially, because God ultimately wants His will to be accomplished. And what is that? He wants you to humble yourself before Him. And sometimes, Dad, you're going to have to make hard decisions. And instead of making calculated moves and calculated decisions, you're just going to have to trust that God has it all under control. And so, yes, it may be hard to put the things that you love in this present life down on an altar, but let me preach to you tonight. Don't you forget that when you put hard things down on the altar of God, that you are showing your children something so much more than just pure vanity. You're not just teaching them how to sacrifice, but you're teaching them how to build a place to sacrifice. You're teaching them how to build an altar. And although it's not always convenient to build altars, trust me, I know, and it's not easy to build altars, but please hear the heart of this young preacher tonight. The life that you build and the character that you build will develop that young man and that young lady that watches you from afar, and you may never even know that they're watching. You build certain altars, but hear me tonight, it makes a difference. You don't understand that the sacrifice, that building their altar and sacrificing your will unto God makes more of a difference than you know. Because it's not the fact that you're doing it. It's that you're doing it in front of them. It's so convenient and easy to go into your prayer closet. Please hear my heart tonight. You can go into your prayer closet inside the secret of your own home, inside the secret of your own room, and you can have communion with God, and you can set aside a place of consecration to God, and your family never even know it. But hear me tonight, that it is important in this present time and in this present world that our children, our young adults, our families are seeing the sacrifice of a mother and a father who are holy and completely sold out to God. So what does this mean? It looks like when you're having financial issues that you come down to an altar and you weep before God. Why? Because your children may not understand the gravity of what you're going through, but they understand the fact that you're not afraid to go before an altar. And maybe you're having marital issues and you don't know your left from your right hand, and you feel like God is not with you, and you don't know the answer to certain situations. But hear me tonight, that you can walk down to an altar and your children will be forever changed because they see the consecration of those that love them. Or maybe you don't have children and you can't, and maybe you have chosen to not. Well, let me preach to you as well that there are elders in this room, that there are adults in this room who you can make a difference because you are a difference. And that by you coming down and building an altar, maybe there is someone that is looking up to you that you have no idea that they are, yet you are helping change the trajectory of their life. But you see, what Abraham teaches Isaac is this, is that in the midst of unfortunate circumstances, and Isaac is being laid on an altar, the fire is about to be lit underneath him. He is bound and he is tied. I can imagine in his own mind, and maybe verbally, he was just saying, God will provide, God will provide, God will provide, God will provide. Why? Because he heard that his dad said that word. Because there is hope. And there is peace at the altar. And so what we find here, instead of it being an altar of sacrifice, it becomes an altar of blessing. And let me tell you tonight that there are blessings when you build altars. It's not all pain, it's not all hurt, and it's not all hard. There are blessings that come with building altars. You see, Abraham was blessed by building an altar, and Abraham's altar of sacrifice turned into a place of blessing. And we can find this later in Genesis 22 and verse number 15. It reads, and the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven, hear this, a second time. And he said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing, because you have put Isaac on the altar, and you've not withheld your son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying, I'll multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gates of its enemies. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Because why? You have obeyed my voice. You have obeyed my voice. And so my call to you here tonight, and maybe you see yourself as an Abraham tonight, is this. There are blessings attached to your sacrifice. But hear this. Don't forget to build the altar first. And as I read this story, I was perplexed with the question in my mind, what about Isaac? What did Isaac do? And we see this blessing that Abraham has been bestowed on by God. And what about Isaac? What kind of emphasis does Isaac put on altars and altarship? And what kind of experience did this cause Isaac to live with? And so, again, I looked at Genesis, the book of Genesis, looking to see what Isaac did after he was put on an altar. And my mind immediately raced. And there's only two things that he could have done. Is not sacrifice because it was a horrible traumatic experience for him. Or he caught it. And he realized that there is something that's more important than just giving on an altar. But rather there is something that I must apply to my life. And so in Genesis chapter number 26 in verse 18 we read, "And Isaac digged again the wells of water which he had digged in the days of Abraham his father, for the Philistines had stopped them after the death of Abraham. And he called their names after names by which his father had called them." And in this portion of scripture, we see that Isaac takes a very similar journey of his father Abraham. And he goes back and he finds these wells that should have brought sustenance, but he realizes that they're filled in by those of the Philistines. And one of the things that actually is intriguing here is that Isaac, he redigs these wells and he finds that there is no fruitfulness there. As we continue to read, Isaac's servants digged in the valley and find the well of springing water. And the herdmen of Gerar did strive with Isaac's herdmen, saying, "The water is ours." And he called the name of the well Esek, because they strove with him. And they digged another well and strove for that also. And he called the name of it Sitnab. And he removed from thence and he digged another well. That's a lot of work. That's a lot of work. But he was looking for something that wasn't there. "And for they strove not against this well. And he called the name of it Rehoboth. And he said, for now the Lord hath made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in this land." And he goes on to Beersheba in verse 24. "The Lord appears unto him in the very same night that he digs the well. And he said, I am the God, hear this, of Abraham your father. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bless thee, and I will multiply thy seed for my servant Abraham's sake." And what does Isaac do? Isaac builds an altar right there. "And he called upon the name of the Lord, and he pitched his tent there, and the servants of Isaac again digged a well." So Isaac here follows the footsteps of Abraham, his father, and it's important to note that he mimics the exact actions of his father in this story. As they go through famine, he goes in and deals with other countries. And so we jump right into the story where he has been asked to leave and to find his own sustenance. And so he goes back to the place of blessing. He goes back to where he knew he could find sustenance. Why? Because he remembered in the back of his mind, ooh, Dad dug wells here. Dad did some things here. And so I'm going to go back and I'm going to grab hold of what was once there. And what does he find? He finds out the things that were there that should have brought him sustenance no longer existed. Why? Because the Philistines had filled them up. And so we read here that Isaac, instead of just being content with the fact that, well, I guess my dad's blessings ran out. No. Instead, what he did was he decided in himself, I also will dig for blessing. And so it's here that Isaac finally digs this well, and he finds that it is good and there's no conflict with those around him. And so he encounters God. And so God again enters into a covenant relationship with Isaac the same way he did with Abraham. And the beauty here is that Isaac, in the midst of being in this now covenantal relationship with God in the same way that Abraham was, he builds an altar. And it's here that Isaac has an encounter with God and he's invited into this covenant. And it's beautiful if you read it, because what God was able to fulfill with Abraham, he makes the same promise to Isaac. And it's a beautiful thing that whenever we fall in line with our elders and we do the good work of God, that God will always come down and he will always have a relationship with us. And yes, it's not always going to be on the same level, but hear me tonight, it will come with the same commitment. And so Isaac again sees that God is providing for him like he did whenever he was laid on the altar. But now Isaac sees, without Abraham being present, that God will still show up. And God will still provide for him. And he builds an altar. And may I remind you tonight that what works for our elders and what works for Pastor Ballestero and Bishop Huntley is still going to work for me. I don't have to walk away and find a new doctrine, a new gospel. Why? Because it's still going to work for me. I don't have to think of other names to pray under, because the same name still works for me. I don't have to look to other people or other things in this world, because it just doesn't add up to what I currently need. Now, no, it still works for me. And so what we find here with Isaac is that he sees his father. Abraham builds an altar that he really wasn't a part of, that he was just a sacrifice. And now we see that Isaac now has the ability to build his own altar. And don't misunderstand me here tonight. It is great that we're able to look at the altars of Abraham and the altars of Brother Huntley, and we're able to look at the commitments that they made and the sacrifices that they made. And it's all well and good. We can still be blessed by those things. Don't hear me wrong. But what's important is that we don't just stop there. That we decide in and of ourselves that there's an altar that I have to build. That Brother Huntley built this church and Pastor Ballestero built this church on the consecration of prayer. And they built this church on the foundation of building altars before God. And don't hear me wrong. And I don't want to step on anybody's toes here tonight. But I can't just coast by knowing that those altars are just still good for me. In my spirit and in my soul, I cannot just get by with thinking that, okay, those are fine, because they're still going to be standing there. They're still going to be, yes, they are, but hear me tonight. If you want to be blessed like never before, if you want to enter into more of a deep relationship with God, if you want to enter into a covenant relationship with God, you've got to put some things on the fire. And you've got to decide that you're going to take some things of your spirit. And although it may be hard and although it may be difficult, that you're going to have to take it out of your spirit and you're going to have to put them down on and build yourself an altar. Why? Because whenever Isaac built the altar, what he learned is that it wasn't just an altar of sacrifice, Brother Nicholas. It was an altar of covenant. And that whenever you begin in your own mind and in your own spirit to decide that I'm going to build things for myself, that I'm going to build things unto God and for God of myself, that I don't have to worry about the fact that I'm walking on mom and dad and being carried by mom and dad's coattails. And I don't have to worry about the fact that I'm riding on Pastor Balcero's coattails because it gets heavy dragging us along. That we have to come to a point in and of ourselves that I must build an altar on my own. That if I want to see God move in the same way that he moved them then, I must build an altar on my own. I wish the spirit of Isaac would rise up in this place saying that it's not enough for me to just get by with what my dad did and what my granddad did, but rather that I might get something inside of myself that says I've got to build something more. Something deeper. Something for myself. Whew. If you want to be blessed and you want to have favor with God, I encourage you to build an altar for yourself. Because here at this altar, what you will find is not an altar of sacrifice per se. But what you will find is an altar where the name of Jesus can be called over your life. Where you can come to the church on your own. And you can come down to this altar when the doors are open throughout the week. And you don't need Brother Ballestero up here preaching his heart out to you. And you don't need worship and music to generate this emotional response within you. But no, instead you can walk through those doors on a Monday morning. And you can come down to an altar and you can build things for God. And as you can probably imagine, I got stuck in the rabbit hole of the lineage of Abraham. For me. I come to a place where, of course, realizing that Jacob is the son of Isaac. And so my immediate thought, again, well, what about Jacob and Esau? What did altars, what kind of importance do they have in their life? And unfortunately, I wasn't able to spend searching through Esau's life. Because Esau gave up his birthright. Esau gave up his blessing. Esau gave up his inheritance and his heritage. So I landed on Jacob, and as I was reading, continuing on this same road, Abraham builds an altar. Isaac builds an altar. And now I'm seeing that Jacob is building an altar. But we must remember with Jacob, we know Jacob as a heel grabber. Or we may know him as the liar, the cheat, the deceiver. And if you spent any time in Sunday school, I know that you have this story memorized and that you don't need Nicholas to tell you about it. But we know that Jacob was always looking for an advantage to be more than everybody else at any cost. And we also know that the one person that Jacob did this to the most was his brother Esau. And what he wanted more than anything was something that was never meant to be his. But here we find in Genesis 35 that Jacob, after making an underhanded deal with Esau to secure this birthright for nothing but a bowl of soup. Now tell me, I'll tell you, my wife made some killer soup the other night. But I'm not giving up blessings for soup. And so maybe that's on Esau. Maybe that's not on Jacob. I don't know. And so he swindles his brother into giving him the birthright. And he cloaks himself in a skin of a beast to manipulate Isaac, his father, into giving him the blessing of the firstborn. And we read here in Genesis 34, actually, that Jacob is in the middle of a terrible peril where his daughters have been defiled by the men of the land that they were dwelling in. The same land that Jacob moved his family to after he fled for fear of his life for being underhanded and being deceitful. And so he flees in fear of death by his brother. And we find that Jacob's sons have now, at this point, killed every single man that was in the town because of the actions against their sister. Those are some good brothers. And Jacob puts his family in the wrong place due to his, if we can call it, own bad decisions. And if you will allow me to add this too, it was because of his own sinful nature. And after all this takes place, Jacob hears the voice of God telling him to go to Bethel. And God asks him to build an altar. And God ends with this little piece of history for Isaac. I am God, the same God who appeared unto you when you first fled from Esau. And we can read this in Genesis 35. And God said unto Jacob, arise and go to Bethel and dwell there and make an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau, thy brother. And so what does Jacob do? Jacob says unto his household, he hears a voice of God first. And he says to his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you, get clean, and change your garments. And let us go up to Bethel, and I will make an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods that were in their hand, and all the earrings which were in their ears, and Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Sichem. And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities round about them. Basically, God protected them so that they could journey, and they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. And Jacob comes to Luz, which is in the land of Canaan, that is Bethel. He and everyone that was with him. And Jacob builds an altar, and he calls the place El Bethel, because there God appeared to him when he fled from the face of his brother. And so Jacob, now he hears the voice of God. And he hears the unction of God telling him to go. There's more for you to do, Jacob. So he does all the right things, right? He puts away the strange gods that the family worshipped. And he puts the things that would hinder them from being clean before God. And he builds an altar. I would like to emphasize here that it's just not enough for one generation to build altars. I really want you to hear my heart tonight. That it's not just okay for you to build an altar one time. It's not just okay to do something once for God. It's not okay for you to just do this one time. Because although building the altar was great for Abraham, it had to become great for Isaac. It had to. And in order for it to be great for Isaac, Jacob had to build an altar. Brother Wall, if you will allow me, sir, it was not enough for you and your wife to just build an altar many, many years ago. It was not enough for you to just build it one time, hoping, taking a chance that Sister Kim and Brother Brandon would just hope to get it. Right? What did you do, Brother Wall? You built altars. You built altars. Kim, Brian, now it was up to you to build altars. Because you saw your dad do it. You saw your mom do it. And what happened is that your altar of sacrifice turned into an altar of blessing. And your altar of blessing turned into an altar of covenant relationship. Why? Because you both were filled with the Holy Ghost. Right? That's what happens whenever you decide to build altars for your family. But it goes further than that. Because you decided to build altars, now Amber and Jordan and Cole and Grant and Aaron, now they have the choice to build altars. And so it doesn't just stop there, because now Grant and Aaron, you get to build altars for Elijah. Hear me tonight, church. And please hear my heart. You've got to build some things. You've got to build some altars. Why? Why? Because Grant, Aaron, may it happen that you have decided to build altars for Elijah. And I pray that our sons and our daughters never leave this wonderful truth, and they never leave this wonderful church. Monroe, Christian, Jaden, you guys, it's not our desire that you ever leave. Ladies, it's not our desire that you ever leave. But on the off chance that you do, there are altars that you can look back at. There are altars that your family has built that whenever you get so far from God and you are able to hear His voice, you can turn yourself around and say, well, Mom and Dad, they built an altar, so that's one that I can run to. Well, Grandma and Grandpa, they built an altar, that's one that I can run to. Pastor, you built an altar, that's one that I can run to. Bishop, you built an altar, that's one that I can run to. Build some altars. And so Isaac, he gets so far from God. He is living with strange gods in his midst. He is living in if we can say this, please, he's living in sin, if you will. And yet, in a moment, God speaks to him. And my prayer is that no matter how far the backslider goes, that they would still hear the voice of God. And if they are able to hear the voice of God, that they would see that there are altars in their past. That there are altars in their past. And what I'm saying here tonight about Jacob is this, is that Jacob's altar of repentance turned into an altar of redemption. And if you build altars, church family, there are blessings, there's covenant relationship, and there's redemption. Oh, I wish someone would hear that tonight. When you build some things for God, it's blessed. You're in relationship, and you have redemption. You have redemption. Tonight I'm preaching to the mom and dads, the grandparents and children, that if you refuse to build altars, if you refuse to spend time in the altar, and if you refuse to show the next generation and the next generation how to love God, how to serve God, how to love truth, how to get into His presence, and how to consecrate yourself before Him, that there won't be any altars for them to turn to if they walk away. Do not be the family that doesn't have altars and just hopes that your kids magically come back. My God, my God. Musicians, you may come to the platform. I'm coming to a close. What I feel here tonight in my spirit, and what I felt for the last 3 weeks since Brother Ballestero has called me to preach tonight, has been confirmed in a multiplicity of ways. Oddly enough, it was confirmed by my brother who preached last Sunday. He preached almost from the same text that I preached from the night. Don't you love when stuff like that happens? And I feel what God is asking us to do as saints, as children of the Most High, as chosen, called by God, is we must... Please, we must understand that we have to be consecrated before God. That we can't just be okay with the frou-frou stuff. We can't just be okay with the chill bumps on our arms. That we can't just be tickled by the Spirit of God moving. That we have to actually have something that we can consecrate our life to. We have to. So don't stub your toe on the altar. If you're like me, you know anything about stubbing your toe, and you have perfected the art, is it comes whenever you least expect it, and it arrives with a vengeance. And most of the time, a stubbed toe, it comes in the middle of the night when the lights are off, and you're the only one awake. And it occurs when we think in our own minds, you know what? I know my way to the bathroom. I don't need to turn on a light. I know my way around. I don't need anything to guide me. I don't need anything to guide me because I know that I can do it on my own. And the problem is that although when we are in our own home, it is true that we very well may possibly be able to get around no problem without any sort of guidance. But the things we stub our toe on the most are oftentimes the biggest piece of furniture in the room. And it's not that we don't remember that the piece of furniture doesn't exist or that it's not there. The issue is we forget where it is, how close we are to it, or how far we've gotten. My prayer for us here tonight is this, that when we walk into the house of God, that we don't fight off the leading of His Spirit, and we don't fight off the leading of His guidance, and we don't fight away that still small voice that draws us closer to Him and that leads us through life, but yet we insist to do it on our own merits and in our own ability. My fear for the people of God in today's world is not the progress that Satan is not making. My fear is an apathy for the altar. If we could all stand all across this room. When we walk into the house of God with the lights off, don't stub your toe on the thing that saved you. Huh. You know it's there. You know it's present. But my fear is that you don't know how close or how far away you are from it. So don't forget that the altar is there. So what happens if I don't think that showing my children or loved ones how to act and operate around the altar, the purpose and spirit behind building things for God, what if I don't think it truly matters? Now, I'll lead you to this portion of scripture and then we will move to our altar call here tonight. 1 Samuel chapter number 2, verse 22. Now Eli was very old and heard all that his sons did unto Israel, and how they lay with the women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And he being Eli, says unto them, why do you do such things? For I hear of these evil dealings by all of the people. Nay, my sons, for it is no good report that I hear. Ye make the Lord's people to transgress. If one man sin against another, the judge shall judge him. But if a man sin against the Lord, who shall entreat for him? And here is the fear. Notwithstanding, the sons of Eli hearken not unto the voice of their father. And this is what happens because the Lord would slay them. And later on in 1 Samuel, the sons of Eli die because of their evil dealings about the altar. If you want to give your children the best shot at living for God, find an altar. If you want your family to stay saved and find help, peace, hope, and restoration, find the altar. You see, the sons of Eli, it was their job to sacrifice upon the altar, to clean the altar, to adhere to the rules of the altar outlined by God, and to be around it at all times, and to help the people of Israel gain atonement for their sins. But what they forgot was the importance and the sanctity for the altar. My spirit tonight here is to consecrate ourselves before the Lord. We need to bind together in our own selves, and we need to come to a place of total and complete consecration to God. And so with lifted hands and with closed eyes here tonight, I want to challenge your spirit. I want to challenge your mind to build an altar. I challenge you that if you somehow relate to any single person in these texts that I read here tonight, maybe you feel you're Abraham, maybe you feel you're Isaac, or maybe you feel that you're Jacob, I encourage you to come down to this altar, and I encourage you to consecrate yourself before God. Because hear me tonight, when we build altars, when we build altars, we find ourselves back in relationship with God. And we can find ourselves back into a hope, knowing that God will make a way. Knowing that God can and that God will. All across this place, I believe it is the will of God that we sacrifice some things on this altar here tonight. I believe it is the will of God that we not only just sacrifice some things, but we show those around us, our children, our loved ones, our families, how to sacrifice on an altar. Let this moment not pass you by tonight without having an opportunity to come back before God and to sacrifice some things before Him. It is the will of God that you build some things in this place. It is the will of God that you sacrifice some things on this altar.
Fire on my altar, never burn out. The fire on my altar.
are around your family. I pray that you would link up with your family, with your loved ones here tonight, because it is time that we build some things together as families. I pray that moms and dads, that you would grip your babies by the head and that you'd pray a prayer over them tonight, that you begin to build some things in their heart tonight. So please find your loved ones as we continue to sing, as we continue to give praise to God. I pray that our families would bind together, because there's an attack upon the families of the church and upon the families of God. And I come against it in the name of the Lord. Lord, I pray right now that you begin to touch these families. God, I pray, Lord, that strength and virtue would go forth, Lord. That your healing power would go forth. I pray that a cover would be placed upon our families. I pray, God, that a cover to protect will be placed upon our families, Lord. Cover our families in your word.